it's a little bit like the explanations the Greeks were satisfied. You know, Aristotle explained falling bodies by saying they're going to their natural place, which is toward the center of the earth. Well, when you say that, you really haven't learned anything more about falling bodies. It hasn't helped you to say that. And in the same way, talking about a God who is complex and created the world the way it is, you haven't learned anything. It doesn't help you to anticipate anything you'll discover in nature. But I don't think one should underestimate the fix we're in, that in the end, we will not be able to explain the world, that we will have some set of laws of nature. We will not be able to derive them on the ground simply of mathematical consistency, because we can already think of mathematically consistent laws that don't describe the world as we know it. And we will always be left with a question, why are the laws of nature what they are rather than some other laws? And I don't see any way out of that. And I just regard it as just another one of the tragedies that we have to get used to, like the tragedy that we will die and the tragedy, well, I don't want to linger on tragedy, but I think essentially the position of human beings is a tragic one. And the more we understand, the more clearly tragic it is. And part of it, which particularly affects a physicist, is the tragedy of never being able to come to a really satisfying conclusion of our questions, why. And what do we do in this tragedy? I think, Shakespeare showed us that one way of living with tragedy is to mix it in with comedy.
Yes, yeah.
And we can take a certain amusement at our position, always seeking why, never coming to the end. I think humor is one of the leavening agents that makes the tragedy of our position possible. The Greeks, in writing their plays, didn't understand that you could mix comedy and tragedy.
Yeah.
There's no comedy in Sophocles. But Shakespeare understood, and I think that's what's so great about Shakespeare.
I think
Shakespeare.
That's right. I mean, moving to another level, I love the comic novels of Douglas Adams. Have you read any of his?
No.
Well, I think you might like them because he uses comedy, but in a rather sophisticated scientific way, and so his jokes would really appeal to a modern physicist who understands.
Well, I've heard of the one. You know, what is the secret of everything, it's 43 or
something. No, yeah, they're much, much better than that. I mean, I can't think of any of that. You might enjoy it. But going back to the tragedy of never finally understanding, I mean, you're making pretty good progress working your way back through the first 3 minutes and getting, where are you now, to the first picosecond or something?
If our present, there's so many powers of 10 that I don't even know what English word to apply to
it.
But we certainly can directly observe the universe as it was when it was 380,000 years old. That's the microwave radiation that comes to us essentially undisturbed from that time. And that's been a great success story in cosmology, the detailed analysis of this radiation that fills the universe, and it's not quite uniform everywhere. It's the non-uniformities that are so interesting.
And so important for what happened later, of course.
Yes, yeah. Well, they are the non-uniformities that ultimately grew into the proto-galaxies, and then galaxies, and then clusters of galaxies, and allowed us to arise. But looking back earlier than the first 380,000 years old, we have theories, and the theories work. In fact, some of our theories that describe what happened when the universe was 3 minutes old tell us the chemical composition with which the stars started. And that works too. I mean, the predictions come out right. There's a certain amount of hydrogen, a certain amount of helium, a certain amount of certain rare isotopes of hydrogen and helium, helium-3 and hydrogen-2, that we can calculate the amounts, and that's what we observe in the oldest stars. So that actually, more accurately, that's what we observe in the intergalactic material out of which the stars form. So in terms of things we can actually observe, I suppose you could say we've traced the history of the universe back to the first 3 minutes. Earlier than that, it's just pure theory, except that these non-uniformities in the microwave radiation, which is so important, which we're studying with radio telescopes, and which we believe and have every reason to believe grew into the distribution of matter we see in the sky, these non-uniformities, we believe we have a theory for their origin in terms of a pre-Big Bang phase called the period of inflation. And it works. That is, it predicts certain properties. For example, the strength of the fluctuations as a function of how large they are. What's the probability of seeing a fluctuation this big as compared to one that big? That theory works, and it deals with a period of time which is incredibly early in the history of the universe, so early that you really begin to wonder whether there really was a beginning, or should you even talk about a beginning. I mean, it's so, I don't even know how to say how early it is, but it's way earlier than the first 380,000 years or the first 3 minutes. It's an incredibly small fraction of a second after the beginning. And those theories seem to work. But, you know, that's only going back so far. Then you have to go back to what started inflation, what started this inflationary period. And we have theories. There are some attractive theories, but they can't be tested. We don't have any observational handle on them.
Even without an observational handle, however, if you've got a theory which is even plausible, I'd be grateful for that.
Well, there is a theory of chaotic inflation due to Andre Linde at Stanford, that there are certain fields, they're the kind of fields we encounter in our modern theories of elementary particle physics. They're known technically as scalar fields that fill the universe, and essentially they're chaotic at the beginning. One does not impose any particular initial condition on the universe. It's just as complicated as you can imagine, which is a nice beginning because you don't have to fine-tune any initial conditions. And this burbles on, and you have fluctuations which are continually increasing and decreasing. It's all very complicated. Every once in a while, sheerly by accident, a patch of this fluctuating field happens to become smooth. That is, it doesn't vary much over a sufficiently large region of space, just by accident, not by any design. That region, you can show according to reasonable dynamical assumptions, will then blow up, will inflate, will increase in size exponentially, becoming smoother and smoother, turning into the inflationary phase, which we think preceded our Big Bang. But this didn't just happen once. It happened again and again, and perhaps time without end. And our Big Bang that is all we can observe directly, that is 13.7 billion years old, and we now know that number to 1%.
Right.
That Big Bang is just one episode in a chaotic universe which is always burping off these Big Bangs.
So does that mean there are lots of universes then?
There are well, what we call a universe, our Big Bang, there are lots of them. I mean, I guess for linguistic purity, one should reserve the word universe for the whole thing, the whole shebang.
Okay.